From last year's LMS representatives that were at the international stage for the region. HQ aiming to try and tie things up and force this series to game five. I welcome you all back to the Global English broadcast. And Oma, we said blue side kind of was the secret sauce when it came to this series. And we're gonna see a Renekton ban finally come out here so that Rest can't or Civ can't blind pick it.
That's true. Nice adaptation from J-Team though. I like the set ban a lot, not giving it away in two first pick from AHQ. This is the first time there'll be a new first pick, I believe.
Oh.
That's what was open. That explains that something wasn't adding up. And Lilia's open. Okay.
So,
yeah, I don't
know if
we've ever seen Kongya. Did he ever play Lilia?
It's his first game.
It's his first game because Hana was the one that constantly picked this one up when it was open.
Oh boy.
All right, so we'll see how Kongya is able to actually fare on this one. This requires them to be hyper-aggressive in that early game and make plays happen. If Lilia doesn't keep up that consistent pressure, she starts to feel like she heavily falls off. For Taipei J Team, though, they're going to go ahead for Lil V, lock in that Jhin. He was able to have an exceptional performance in the previous game on it, going up into the double digit when it came to the kills, and we'll see whether or not he's able to replicate that now for Taipei J Team.
Interesting choice of the Graves into Lilia. Not typically what we see in other regions as well, because we typically see Lilia as a kind of an answer to Graves as well, because like she does magic damage, she clears fast, she can outrun the Graves. A lot of factors play into this one. Normally we would see something like a Hecarim, but it makes sense that Hana is just defaulting back to something that he's very comfortable with, and he's played a lot of Lilia, so he probably knows how to play this matchup better than I do. So interesting one for sure.
Oh no. Are we seeing this blind Lucian again? This has been creeping up a lot into the PCS, and it could be going into a solo lane either for Civ or Uniboy, but still could be played by Wako, but it's usually never the case.
Yeah, probably going to Uniboy. Like, he maybe just wants to smurf a nasty show mid-gap or something. It's not impossible to play into the bot. Oh, well, there we go. Ashe is being hovered as well, so not going to be Lucian in the bot lane.
Yeah, I think it could, just as you guys mentioned, could possibly go towards Uniboy or towards Ziv, because Uniboy did play one Kalista mid back in spring and it worked wonders, especially if HQ is anticipating Nesty on a melee matchup.
That works.
Yeah. Oh well.
That is not fun if you're an AD carry player. Lil V is actually just tilted for Wako at this point. Because he knows this is not going to be a fun time for them. He's like, all right, this should be pretty easy. But a Malphite lock-in, we are going up against two AD carries or two marksmen. Oh, that is just disgusting already coming out here from Taipei J Team during this draft.
It's a good pick for sure, and I like it a bit more than the Garen that we saw previously. It's not great in the early game against Lucian. You are going to get pushed in, your Lilia is going to get prio, but then it comes down to what Kongya can accomplish with this lead in the early game, what Uniboy can accomplish as well, because once it gets to the mid to late game stages, like you guys talked about, double ADC into Malphite, it's not going to be very fun.
Yeah, and the potential setup too, a lot of squishy members on the board already for AHQ, and I mean, a little bit of mobility on the side of the Lucian at least, but Wako has to be a little bit careful, again, of his positioning, because Malphite is also one way to do great punish on such as Wako.
So I'm interested like Omo, coming from an analyst approach here, if you're HQ, what are you doing right now to adapt this draft now that you have seen this Malphite get locked in?
Yeah, it's not easy, because like you see in the bans right now as well, they don't know whether they should be banning for mid, they don't know whether they should be banning for top, because it's still a flex pick, and it makes life really hard because they can hold the Malphite flex until last pick. On the side of AHQ, Lilia by itself is already not too bad, because you do magic damage, you can run really, really fast, maybe even dodge the Malphite ultimate and then play around teamfights on the outskirts as well. The problem right now is they need to adapt in the sense that they need to have options in this team comp. They can't play something like a Siege comp. They can't play something like a split push, because Malphite's just going to punish with hard engage. So it looks like the route that they're going to go themselves is just all in engage onto the Malphite team comp. Like, go and kill them before they kill you.
Yeah, and you're right. It's one of those things where whoever pushes the go button first will be able to win. And the Leona enables that, and now they're
double flex
the
at least.
It's double flex, but this is a squishy damn team comp if I've ever seen one. Your only real tank is pretty much this Leona. To a degree, Lilia gets a little bit tanky once she gets a couple items, but it's mainly just health, nothing really soaking it up. And when you lock in something like a Camille now for Taipei J team that can chunk out squishy members once they're locked down with the Hextech Ultimatum, it's a very scary game four here for AHQ.
Yeah, you have to assume that it's going to be Camille into Akali. Yeah, Camille into Akali topside is what it's looking at right now, which is a bit unusual because Akali does have a good matchup into Camille, but I guess the game plan is really simple. They're just going to pick one member on the side of HQ and everyone's going to press R. They're going to delete him and then they're going to play the game out from there. So that seems to be a very straightforward plan from JT. They just want to kill somebody really, really fast, and it makes their life easier because everyone on the side of HQ is really mobile. Like the Lucian, the Lilia, it's all really mobile. Wako's there for sure though. Like, we don't really have to talk about that. So
yeah, Wako, unfortunately, this playoff run has not been his to have, it seems.
Yeah.
Again, we mentioned off cam that positioning, especially in game two, was, for the lack of a better word, brutal. And he's going to need to shore up that positioning come game four. Because now, of course, it is do or die. AHQ cannot lose another game where they will be eliminated from summer playoffs. Taipei J team only one victory away from locking in their ticket into the lower bracket final, where they will have the opportunity to fight for one of the two world seeds to represent the PCS on the world stage. For now, we're going to go ahead and load on in for game four. Crazy to say that we are at this position now where, you know, AHQ looking down the barrel at being eliminated by Taipei J team. Of course, this is our first and second seed. We expected this to be our winner's final. We expected this to be a matchup that would decide one of the two seeds heading into Worlds for the PCS. But now it's in our lower bracket semifinal. Worlds isn't on the line anymore. This is just about survival for both of these squads. And AHQ, it's only one Nexus J team needs to take, and they are eliminated here and now. And for them, that would be a massive blow to this organization that has been a stable name when it comes to the former LMS, only, of course, missing Worlds once in the last 5 years, that being back in 2018. For Taipei J team, if they're able to win, they have the opportunity of making that run back and being, of course, one of those teams representing the region, similar to what they were back last year in 2019.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, for AHQ, looking to find the new generation to carry on the AHQ name for to take them to Worlds, considering that, you know, they've got a retained synergy down a bot side with Wako and Sarah, and they've got another retained duo, which is Kongyi and Uniboy. So on paper, it's been looking really strong for AHQ, but towards the playoffs, they've been struggling against J Team, who has risen from the dead, I suppose. I mean, they finished insanely strong in the LMS before the PCS arrived, but expectations were sort of shut down after their seventh place run when it comes to the regular season of spring.
Yeah, that's the shocking point for me, and I think that shocked a lot of our analysts too. You know, the spring performance of J Team, everyone kind of wondered, you know, with the departure of Fofo during the postseason, was it truly just the Fofo show? And it truly did kind of look like that. We didn't really get to see Rest or Hana kind of come into the form that we did see finally here in summer. I don't know if it was a change in scrim or, you know, practice philosophy that was able to kind of resurge them back into this state that they look like one of the top teams from the region. But then that question, like you mentioned, for AHQ, on paper, this was supposed to be the new and improved AHQ. You're supposed to have, you know, a hyper strong mid jungle duo that had years of experience with one another and were a strong point of the region. There were rumors that Kongyu was going to go to the LPL, but then he stayed back within the region. And you had Civ, again, this veteran of a top laner that now looks at this dive and has the question, how am I going to get himself out of this? Goes into the cloak, rest, soaks up the first tower shot. Hana, though, waiting for him, and poor Civ, unfortunately, he's got really nowhere to run, and we're already seeing that aggression come out of Taipei J Team as they strike with first blood.
Very difficult spot to be on, especially you're already at the back end of things when it comes to the series matchup. And that is not the start that you're looking for, I suppose, especially Ziv. I cannot really do anything as an Akali with how strong Rest and Hana is in their picks in particular.
And there you are. Unfortunately for Ziv, he just gets canned. Nothing he could really do. The early levels just weren't going in his favor, and Rest is going to be happy at least picking up a quick and easy call off his first back. And there you are. Camille getting ahead early with that extra assist. We'll see. Our question now is, Kongyu actually going to be able to make a proper play somewhere on the map here with this Lilia? Because the fact that Hana's already strike first in this matchup is a bit devastating to HQ's plan early.
Lilia so far has been very 50-50 in the tournament. Only we've seen a huge success over at, I believe, J-Team's and PSG talent side. And just as we mentioned earlier, this is Kongya's first time on the champion, and we'll have to see whether or not they're able to get ahead and hopefully be able to snowball, get that reset on towards that series. So far, at least, though, Uniboy is able to poke out an ST, which is the expected result of this matchup in particular. Level 6 will definitely be insanely scary, but at least for Uniboy, he does have a lot of mobility to work with to dodge out that unstoppable force.
Yeah, this, like we mentioned, this is pretty much, you know, Uniboy laying down the law and saying, all right, you know what, I'm here for the kill in lane. He's got the ignite. He wants to try and take down Nesty as much as possible, and we'll see if that's going to be the case. The thing that worries me, and I mentioned it already before, this is a very squishy composition. They do have lots of carry threats, so hopefully Nesty isn't able to hit all of them at the same time, but one really good Malphite ultimate comboed into a Camille Hextech ultimatum, and it can be rather, it'll be devastating for AHQ when it comes to some of these team fights if they're not careful.
Absolutely, that's why they're trying to look into getting ahead, just to get ahead in terms of not allowing Nesty to be the tank, the reliable tank and scary tank in the later stages of the game. So while they're all squishy, it's time. We'll see whether or not HQ is able to take advantage of that time window. But just as you mentioned, as the game progresses, no one will be able to deal with Rest, and no one will be able to deal with Nesty later on as well. Easy ult, easy setup. HQ might be in trouble if the game goes on the long run.
And once again, poor Ziv, he's just going to get dove again. It is rather risky to try and dive while you have a graze, but if you're going to bring in the squad level 6 Malphite, easy ultimate combo from the Hextech ultimatum, and ST's now on the board. Uniboy was back in base, wasn't able to pressure anything mid. Sure, he's gone one turret plate so far, but top lane is starting to bleed heavily for AHQ.
Yeah, I mean, forget the team fight. You can do this too, get Nesty on the board. It's not on the Pantheon, it's not on the Galio this time around, but he does have Teleport, he does have that spellbook, and is able to cleanly eliminate Ziv once more, putting the Akali even more behind, and putting Rest even further into the lead. HQ, though, responds with a Dragon take, at least, to exchange off of that, and therefore sort of equalizes it a bit map-wise.
At least you're able to get an objective, get some extra cooldown reduction onto your ultimates, but outside of that, it does mean we're either going to have a Mountain Soul or Ocean Soul. So for AHQ, maybe they continue stacking that, and maybe they give up just that topside pressure, and they're able to transition that into an early Soul. We'll see, though, if Taipei J Team look to respond, because now the fact that Rest is picked up a Sheen on top of already stacking that call, it's going to have that big amount of just burst of gold coming into his back pocket in about 5 minutes that should net him a Trinity Force online, and it's going to be hell for Civ to deal with that in a side lane.
Yeah, definitely hell, considering that if J-Team continues to pressure topside even more, therefore having a little bit more control over that Rift Herald. Rift Herald means you can decide to put more platings on towards Rest, making him do the split push work early and become an early pressure threat on towards the side lanes.
Taking a look elsewhere, we do see Berserkers coming online there for Wako, as he's looking for some of those more extended fights. I'm interested to see from Uniboy. Looks like it's going to be the Essence Reaver build that we've been seeing out of the mid lane Lucians, at the very least, as he's gone into a BF sword. So just looking for that cooldown reduction as well as just that sustain for the mana. In all honesty, Nesty at least picking up that kill has equaled him out. So that's kind of the one benefit for HQ, is if Uniboy is able to maintain this pressure, this Lucian's going to kindly just freely scale up. But even with that first just Bramble Vest pickup, he's able to soak up a decent amount of this damage that Uniboy is throwing out to him.
Exactly. As, again, Nesty's job is to not die and hopefully be able to participate into these fights, get a magnificent setup onto that unstoppable force. Hana, though, is actually got scared off of that Rift Herald take. Definitely a lot of damage output from Kanye and Uniboy on their picks. Therefore, still a lot of respect.
You saw there Ysera and Wako already rotating toward the top side of the map. That Shelly, though, Rift Herald, was an easy take there for HQ, and that kind of means that Lil V and Woody just get free reign in the bot lane. It looks like that's going to be turret plating going on over. So, though they get the Rift Herald, I think Wako and Ysera actually wasted a little bit of time. And for Wako, sure, he's ahead in CS once more, but Lil V is going to be happy getting at least a turret plate onto this gym.
Yeah, exactly. I think HQ anticipated the J-Team wants another fight in the Rift Herald, because that has been the trend for the series in particular, is even though teams can give up an objective, they're still wanting to fight. But J-Team is treating this game in particular as delicate as they could be, just because they are already at match point and therefore can't afford to give up objectives and can't afford not to be greedy at this point.
Well, you know, usually you expect level 6 Malphite. You know, Malphite go burr. He did do that off the teleport, so maybe it's fair to say that HQ were maybe expecting a little bit of action, considering Civ has already been put down so far. He's had to go for the Seeker's first item, which doesn't feel great if you're an Akali. You'd love to try and get into your Evolver right away, but not the case, as Rest again, just having free reign in this matchup and already up about 20 CS on top of the 2 assists that he has, and almost nets himself about 1,000 gold lead in the matchup.
Yeah, forced to be a little bit more defensive to survive any of the harass coming from Rest, just because he is just ahead because of Hana's constant pressure. Pigs are actually coming from HQ in the deeper parts of J-Team's jungle, but it's all about vision control, at least to set up for the next objective, which is that Infernal Drake that HQ is looking to pile on over and deny that once more against J-Team.
And so they're calling you, just going to go ahead, lay down Shelly in mid lane, and that should net Uniboy a couple turret plates for this Lucian. Picks up an extra 160 gold there, shared that with Kongya. Kind of waiting. We do expect that AHQ are the ones that want to try and start something up here, because you do have this Lilia. She's finished off her first item. She again has a big impact during some of these team fights, and already lots of position coming out from AHQ in that deep ward coverage, forcing J-Team to be the ones that put down the control wards, trying to clear that out. Hana, though, shows himself mid and is within striking distance of that Dragon Pit if he needs to be.
Well, you did mention earlier, level 6 already for most of these teams, so if they are able to set up a fight. Omo also brought up who gets to pull the trigger first will be able to win, especially if Nesty is able to get a magnificent maybe 2-man knockup, especially everyone's practically very squishy on HQ side, and we'll have to see, because HQ also has that solar flare at least, but a lot of hesitation. No one is still nearby on that Dragon Pit as Hana actually makes his way towards topside.
Topside, because guess what? Rest is again just able to push in this tower, and unfortunately Ziv can't really do a whole lot about it, as Rest has picked up that Sheen early on. HQ are able to at least pick up the second Drake, so they are setting themselves up for an early soul point. Maybe not the one they were hoping for. Instead, they get Mountain over Ocean. We do see engage comes in from this bot lane on the side of Wako. Drowsy's going to land. We'll see Ysera pops in toward that solar flare. And that's going to be the first kill for HQ on the board. Ysera, though, going to go down here as Rest is able to pick that up on the teleport play. Civ also nearby, but it's a bit of a waste. He's not able to do much else. And it's a trade one for one as Rest finds himself another kill. Meanwhile, top lane, Hana's going to get some damage here onto the first tier tower.
JG just did a bit of a switch. They're playing so differently right now. They're playing a little bit more on the reactive side, which is, in this case, it's definitely not bad at all, because HQ, again, on the back end of the series, their J team is just playing towards the punish. They get a little bit too excited, and that's what happened. Rest comes in with that teleport. They're able to even things out with a 1-1. The thing is, they're able to equalize or get a better lead because of that plating at topside. But, I mean, still, good for HQ to pull the trigger, but unfortunately, it was an even trade.
Yeah, Ysera tanking up all that damage, unfortunately, not a whole lot else that he could do, and it kind of gets a little bit concerning here, because you take a look toward item builds, Training Force online for Rest, as well as now that completed call, so he just got a bunch of extra gold into his back pocket. This Camille does chunks, both to members of HQ, as well as turrets. Turret plating is down, though, so not going to be able to snowball out of control just yet. But again, Civ, we're not going to see a whole lot out of him until he finishes off his first item, which is, of course, delayed by that Seekers. And also take a note here. Mid lane, unfortunately for Uniboy, he's going to be able to push in the lane, but that's pretty much it. Nest is kind of unkillable at this point now that he's picked up Ninja Tabbies as well as that Bramble. And unfortunately, Uniboy is just going to be kind of doing a little bit of damage here and there. And Lil V's looking for first brick up in top lane.
And that's the thing, HQ was hoping to get ahead maybe in one of the solo lanes to help propel, but Nesty is already on a situation on where he can just try to trade against Uniboy when he decides to dash in. Now HQ's call is to try and zone and keep an eye on towards Hana. There's not a lot of objectives to take off of the map just yet. Maybe the Rift Herald that's going to be spawning in a few seconds. But HQ making their presence known at the bottom side of the map. But looking at top side, a little bit more damage already, as again, Hana was able to push that out earlier. And more room for J Team to move around the map.
My main issue is this exactly, as Rest can just slingshot in comes that damage from Hana, and poor Wako, in comes the depth charge. Rest able to survive too, as Ysera gets taken down. Rest now with a double kill. And as far as the carry versus carry matchup, coaching staff from J Team still very happy, as now Rest finds himself 3-0-2 on this Camille, and Civ has yet to answer for anything on this Akali.
J Team looking really solid at the moment, as Kongye is going to be safer now. But yes, that was an amazing play, because HQ was trying to fish for a play themselves, but Rest pulled that trigger down. You just aren't able to go towards the carries of HQ. And it's easy. Kongye, the thing is, he was just nearby as well having the farm, but unfortunately with three members diving into two, there's literally no escape.
And the fact is, Hana's the one that's been able to actually impact the map. And unfortunately for HQ, one of their strong points throughout the regular season this year was the fact that Kongye, Uniboy, they were this duo that was hyper-aggressive early. They would get control of the map immediately. We've just not seen this from the Lilia. We've only seen the one gank in toward the bot side of the map, and it was a forced dive that was traded one for one. And guess what now? Nesty, Thornmail complete. No one's going to be able to deal with this Malphite. Wako only has a Bork. He isn't going to a high damage build. He has a lot of DPS against squishy targets. But against a tank, he's going to do nothing. At this moment, it does feel pretty doomed here for HQ. This draft has come out clean for Taipei J Team. We'll see what they're able here as Nesty. They soaked up three ultimates from the side of HQ. He has his ultimate, gets himself back over to safety. Not going to use his flash, though, as he's able to be patient, but you see how much has to be invested just to kill a Malphite.
Yeah, there's no Solar Flare anymore, there's no Crystal Arrow, and Culling is also out of the window. And for HQ, this gives them room at least to take something out of the map, since J-Team had free reign for the first 17 minutes of the game. HQ, though, is looking in towards at least getting closer to that Dragon Soul, deny that away from J-Team as well, remove, deny more stats and buffs away from them. And this is Nesty just strolling around casually without vision in the deeper portions of HQ's jungle.
Yeah, again, Taipei J team, at this point, they've already opened up the top side of the map, and it's kind of weird that they have, again, just put the Jin. But here we go. Engage comes out. That's the knock-up on over to Uniboy. NST does not have his ultimate for this fight. He is just strolling down. So a little bit of a haphazard approach coming out from Taipei J team, as they are the ones that wanted to try and force this fight. And on top of that, they're able to prevent the soul point being set up by AHQ early, which delays it and gives J-Team just more time to do what they wish with this composition.
And when we look back at what Nesty, we thought it was a mistake, but because three members invested their ult onto just to get Nesty, that means they didn't have anything available to get towards this dragon. So in hindsight, J-Team still definitely has won that. And is able to slow down HQ's dragon take as well in towards that soul point. And yeah, it's looking pretty dire as Nesty chasing down Uniboy.
Uniboy, unfortunately, Nesty hasn't even used his ultimate yet. He's waiting for Uniboy to blow his flash, can't even use it. And there you go, a solo kill coming out from the Malphite. And Uniboy, this whole idea of this Lucian pick that's supposed to be dominating this 1v1 matchup doesn't happen.
Yeah, the time window, the time frame is already a bit too late already against NST. They were hoping before NST has garnered a bunch of, like, maybe one item completed, put him behind. But NST is able to get gold, if not in the lane, but through kills and influence through the side lanes, which is Kong-It?
Oh, Kong-It.
Oh, no!
Come on, mate. Even uses his ultimate. That's something he's going to want back as in comes Rest. And Kongyu forced to flash as Rest was positioning himself for the slingshot. Ended up missing the actual jump. But a bit of comedy of errors on the top side of the map. And Kongyu not able to do much with that ultimate once again.
The big differences from those mistakes is that JTM can sort of afford that, but for HQ, they will need every single opportunity to get themselves back on the board. And this is the point where Nesty, Uniboy both has flash, and it's all about the mind games. But Nesty didn't even, both of these players didn't even have to use flash, and Uniboy had to accept his fate of that death. And that puts Nesty on a very comfortable position to become a solid threat against the double AD composition that HQ has.
There we are. You take a look at the gold ranking. That's all three carries on the side of Taipei J team with an advantage. Rest is absolutely huge at this point. Once he gets Death's Dance, it's going to be rather difficult. We do see Ziv finally coming online with his first item on this Akali. So maybe he gets this backline access and is able to get the assassination on Lil V, but it's a lot of ifs right now for AHQ, and you don't want to be playing in that position, especially when you are facing elimination if you lose this individual game to Taipei J team that currently sits at a 3,000 gold lead at 20 minutes.
Pressure is definitely building in towards this series in particular. And I guess the biggest question is whether or not HQ is still able to make this composition work, because imagine if J team is grouped as fives, and it's going to be a little bit difficult to find these opportunities, because while you do have backlane access, so is J team, and they really do pack a punch.
Some aggression coming out. Woody with a long hook is able to find it immediately onto Kong. And Woody, though, gets taken on down. Nesty has joined in onto the fight. Has flash and his ultimate available. Could look to turn this one back around. Ysera. Engage comes out. They get on top of Rest. And this is what we talked about. If you're able to get the individual picks. But no, Nesty prevents access by Ziv. Uniboy trying to flash on forward. And Nesty saves his top laner.
Nesty with a crazy save with his unstoppable force and no cash in, no bounty cash in that HQ is able to get off of Rest, and he saves his teammate. What an amazing play by Nesty.
And here we go. Baron being started. HQ are the ones that are trying to burn this down immediately. Ysera, Vera down low, has to get the heal out. You see that damage coming out from Lil V. Kongyu, though, able to find the kill. Uniboy getting too far forward. Nesty now joining in onto the fight, and the fourth bullet now getting lined up. The W lands. Wako set up. He's going to get taken on down. Lil V again with a double kill and an absolute monster on this Jin as Rest is able to sweep clean the roster of HQ as they get taken down. Three members out off the attempt toward the Baron, and ends up costing AHQ everything.
And even though you have a lot of damage output from HQ's composition to take down that Baron, you're also at the same time very squishy, and therefore J Team is going to easily punish you if you take too long, as he had to tank so much already. Isera was the one that did it, but unfortunately the collapse is just so much easier to execute because you do have a more reliable frontline with Woody and as well as Nesty on board.
And you see here Woody gets that hook to start things off, and it looks rather good for AHQ. But the fact that at the end of this play, Rest is able to survive, and to be honest, Nesty only helped out by just getting that ultimate off. It was actually going to be a misplay as Rest was able to go into the Hextech ultimatum, but still impressive, and it nets them the ability to then contest over this Baron that was attempted by AHQ.
Yeah, it looked pretty solid for AHQ already. Managed to scare the rest of the members from J Team to reset back to base. Teleports are also already used, but Nesty decided to stick around, Han and Lil V as well, and it was enough. This pincer attack, HQ was forced to move towards the mid lane, therefore in the loving arms of the rest of Type A J Team that has already gone from the base towards this Riverside.
And even then, you see, Nesty doesn't even have his ult. Imagine he has ultimate in that choke point, and it's a completely different story, where instead of just, you know, one or two people getting aced, the entire team just gets taken off the map. And unfortunately, Uniboy, if he's not able to create distance between him and, Lord, Rest, with that precision protocol, able to just destroy Ziv off two combos. Ziv, yeah. Start dancing your way back to base. Rest could even look for the play underneath the tower. Doesn't want to risk it though. Cloak is available for the Akali. But yeah, this is disgusting. Ziv cannot do anything in this matchup.
Yeah, not at all. Zero. Ever since, you know, Hana has been putting a lot of effort to get Rest ahead, it is now having to equal into such a huge deal, especially at this point of the game where Rest can just keep split pushing and HQ is forced to invest more members to catch Rest off guard. But 404, 400 gold on his bounty, death sentence, a death stance already completed as well. There's a
Woody,
fight.
Engage, you did see the drowsy not being used just yet by Konya. Current call comes out, three hits, fourth one gonna land onto Ysera. Doesn't actually get the kill though, only putting Leona down to half health. Rest though, procs his protocol, ready to go for the engage off his sling, but it's not going to be happening with the hookshot. Interesting enough too, we saw the items briefly before the fight. Interesting that Han has actually opted into going for a Black Cleaver instead of the Glaive. Another engage onto Woody. A lot used, they're able to take down the Nautilus, but does Taipei J Team actually look to respond? The answer is no, and going back to what I was about to say about Hana, would have liked to see the Glaive here to at least try and deny some of the vision away from AHQ so that Woody can look for some of these kind of packs.
Yeah, exactly, because Woody was a little bit comfortable, I suppose, hoping that AHQ will not go in a hunting squad just to find any sort of disjointed members still looking towards going back to base, but unfortunately that's not the case. Good thing is though, any sort of dragon was not present during Woody's death, therefore J Team can afford that death, I suppose, because HQ, again, because of their composition, makes it a little bit dicey to even consider the Baron. They don't want the same thing to happen again where they got pincered and everybody just falls into pieces. And now the Nesty though is still a huge threat, even though, let's just say, well, his lane actually went pretty well. Yeah,
his lane went well. CS numbers post lane. Well, he's a Malphite. What do you expect? He's just there to try and soak up what he could. And soon he's going to have that Iceborne, which means, let's see. That's an aggressive play. They really want to go on Ziv.
Yes,
I don't think Rest really needed the help here, but in comes Nesty just to make sure. In comes the arrow, though. Ziv not taken on down. Rest has to go back into stasis. Whoa. Stopwatch going to be used. Konya here for the save, and Hana misses on the collateral damage. Not able to take down Ziv. Was just used a couple frames early. And Ziv actually escapes with his life, and that is Flash as well as Teleport being burned here by Nesty.
Good thing Nesty teleported, or else I feel like that was the HQ is able to cash in that 400 gold bounty already and finally eliminate Rest. But Type A J Team and as well as HQ very quick to respond to that aggression, and therefore no kills will equal to that, but still the threat is still on board that even though Rest was ahead, there's still the threat of Han on this Graves and as well as Lil V on this Jhin.
I'm getting a bit concerned here now, though, because we've been talking about Nessie, we've been talking about Rest, and like you mentioned, the Jhin for Lil V is kind of that sleeper agent right now in this composition that at any point can actually add on to a fight. And he's currently sitting on, what, three items to, again, Waka, which, again, you have a lot of DPS when it comes to this Ashe in the form of the Bork and Runans, but that instant just chunk damage that comes out from Lil V, and we saw what happens in the previous game when he comes online. I feel like Waka, there just isn't enough safety. We see Rest maybe looking for a play, but instead setting up for now Taipei J Team's third Mountain Drake, stacking up the resistances and looking to set themselves up for Soul Point on the next spawn.
Exactly. When we look at the composition of Taipei J Team, they're much more solid when it comes to the later stages of the game, especially in their 5v5s. And now look at that very fast Dragon.
Engage comes out here. Lil V gets tagged there by the Drowsy. We'll see if Nessie tries to turn this one on back. That's a beautiful choke point. Able to get only in a knockup onto the Leona. Now the main damage dealers of AHQ are back online, but you see Rest able to find himself a double. Civ gets taken on down. Uniboy and Waco have to carry back the fight. Lil V flashing on forward. Uniboy stands his ground, but unfortunately he's going to get put in the ground. It's a double kill for Lil V as they find the ace against AHQ.
And the two carries survive, and the front line of J-Team is able to do their job. And now, it's just free reign of Han and J-Team, or Lil V, to just put down objectives. And the thing is, they got the dragon already. AHQ just wanted to start this fight again.
And this is the issue, too. This is Nesty only hitting Leona. What happens when Waco gets hit? What happens when Uniboy gets hit and Civ trying his darnest, but he has to get onto Lil V. He has to find this assassination. But if he's not able to, unfortunately, this is the result that we are going to see time and time again if Lil V is able to survive these fights, now sitting 4-0-5 with 320 CS before 30 minutes.
Very tragic for AHQ. This is looking into a game where they're unable to get things even into the series and survive a little bit more. And J-Team, they switch their air quote personality and attitude towards this fight, becoming a little bit more patient, but their aggression has been very more on the calculated side of things. And yeah, it's looking a little bit dire, especially when Isera is the first one to fall in towards the fight. No frontline already. Even though Kongi is able to get two tags for a setup on that Drowsy, but he died so fast, and this Lilia is not getting a lot of value into this game in particular.
So now reset up here for Taipei J Team. Rest now has GA. Woohoo. No one can contest this Camille in the side lane outside of Rest making a mistake. You also have him with teleport available, can rejoin in onto the fight. 2.5 minutes until we have that sixth dragon to spawn, and for Taipei J Team, that is Mountain Soul if they are able to secure it. At that point, Nesty gonna be near unkillable. He has also finished off his Iceborne. He's able to then continue to just keep on to these squishy targets of AHQ, and Rest has been able to take the second tier tower. We have not seen a sign of life from AHQ outside of an overstep from Taipei J Team. That is something that is uncharacteristic for AHQ. This was the team that was hyper-aggressive. This was the team with the jungle mid duo of the Bloody Regent. And we have not seen it during this series. They're supposed to have a consistent 80 carry in the bot lane. Waco's been out of position all of playoffs. The Taipei J Team look to be back in form after what many considered to be exposed in the Machi series. And they're, again, very close to locking in their ticket into the loser bracket final.
Yeah, definitely. It's all about who is able to adjust during the series, because for both of these teams, they look incredibly messy and incredibly greedy. But at this point, J Team is able to adjust, wanting to just shut down any sort of chances for AHQ to take it to game number 5. And it's looking like that situation itself. 1 minute on the clock, more or less, for the next dragon to spawn. The biggest question is, will AHQ be able to deny that? Because you did mention, tanky members are gonna get even more tankier. It's gonna be, I mean, Rest was already hard to kill. He only has one death so far, has been close to death many, many times. Death Stance, Guardian Angel makes that even harder. And Tia, J Team now hoping to close this game out with that Baron. Now their focus on this point of the game.
So again, pings coming out here. Taipei J Team looking for Ysera. Ysera gets caught out on the Leona once again, going to get rooted up. And they don't even have to use the Malphite ultimate to look for these kind of picks. As Ysera way too far forward without the vision line being there. The fact that Taipei J Team can just engage upon you from over a screen away spells disaster. And Ysera being caught out. Odd man advantage over to Taipei J Team on this Baron.
And your single front lane is gone. There's a teleport though. This is HQ making their last stand.
HQ have to try and find a play. Nesty though in prime position to find a multi-man knockup. 4,000 health onto the Baron. HQ at this point have to spell the end. It's all over at this point. Knockup onto Wako. Wako gets himself to safety. Unit Boy though goes down and Wako follows back. Kongya tries to turn back a fight, but Civ with barely any health. And at that point, you have to say this is the nail in the coffin for AHQ's season. It's Taipei J Team now with a 10,000 gold lead, Baron buff in hand, and Ziv trying to escape within the base.
Baron buff in hand, coffin prepared, and right now Ziv is just trying to buy some time with J Team already knocking towards the base.
And there you go for AHQ. This team, unfortunately, will not be making it back to the world stage this year. The second time in over 6 years, this team has not been able to make it to an international event, and Taipei J Team remain as the lone LMS team from the former region to be able to represent the region if they are able to win the lower bracket final as they knock out AHQ 3-1.
Look at them, they're incredibly happy, and it looked shaky in their previous series, especially against Machi, but they've managed to repair some of their weaknesses and strengthen their side of things. And what a win, 3-1 finish against AHQ.
And it comes back to, I think, a lot about this draft where Taipei J Team, they don't even need blue side Omo. All right, they got themselves a big old Malphite. They got Uniboy that's on, you know, Lucian, but then, you know, Malphite gets like two items and he goes, I guess I do nothing in this matchup anymore.
Yeah, that's true. I mean, that's pretty much what we talked about in draft as well. They had to abuse the early game. Kongyue as well, just Uniboy had to take over the game, and they tried their best given how the early game played out. They took a dragon, they took a Rift Herald, but I have to give props to Rest as well as Hana. They synced their early game coordination so well. They played the top lane dive so well. Rest won the first few trades early on in the top lane. He played the matchup really well, synced up a few waves crashing in, and got Hana coming in as well for the dive, and that just completely shut down Ziv. We beat it again with the TP, and honestly, props to them. Like, that took over the tempo for the whole game, and the Lucian just couldn't really do anything from that point forward.
Yeah, pre-level 6 was just all about Taipei J Team, and once level 6 came, it even strengthened Taipei J Team even more, and we didn't really see Kongya try to exchange things off of the map, except for maybe a few dragons, but it was a little bit too late already because, again, the stronger lanes had already been propelled on Taipei J Team side.
After seeing the Machi series up against Taipei J Team, again, the questions again flowed on through was, you know, this mid lane hole that Nesty has found himself. Well, if he digs down into the niche champ pool like that, gets a little bit creative. But then you start to find success in being able to play through a victory in on Rest. That gives me a little bit more hope now for this team maybe coming to an international, but still they have to face up against either PSG Talon or Machi Esports. And we saw what Machi was able to do to J Team previously, where they dismantled that matchup in mid. I don't know if they're going to have a second opportunity like they did in this one up against AHQ.
Yeah, honestly, I think if they face up against Machi again, we're pretty much going to be seeing the same thing in the mid lane. I think regardless of what cheesy picks Nesty has prepared, Mission is just too stable and his champion pool is just too well-rounded to be abused like what we saw today from Uniboy. Like, Uniboy was winning some lanes, he had CS advantages, but he just wasn't able to do enough, and I don't think that's true for Mission. I feel like if you give Mission some of these matchups, like let's say he plays Orianna into Pantheon and he's like 50 CS up, I definitely think he's in a very good spot to carry the game.
Yeah, there were so many things where, like, for example, just as you mentioned, the Pantheon, even though he wasn't felt at all at the early stages of the game, J Team is able to get away with it. And the biggest question is, can they still get away with those types of approach to the game, especially with such a consistent and patient team such as Machi?
And it kind of comes back to this play, which I felt like for HQ was rather forced. I don't think they need to necessarily go exactly for this Baron play, but they ended up saying, hey, we have to try and make a risky call here. We need to try and find a way back into this game. But at this point, it just felt doomed once Lil V gets back online with his gear.
It looks really desperate.